brother prays he'll be back next week.
I don't think so. We can let him say it. They should have had a whole month.
We second that.
D said he tired already, so y'all got him 3 months. 3 weeks.
Encore.
One person can sing in the church. One man. That God has blessed us with a quartet. Amen. Bless our musicians as they come to support this ministry. Let's give them a hand as well. Chapter 4, verse 1. Let us pray. Most heavenly, gracious Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. And Father, as yes, we need you to continue to hold our hands. For Lord, your covenant is, you are God and we are people. So Lord, let us continue to hear from you. Bless us now, Lord, to receive a revelation from you. Holy Spirit, we yield to your way and to your will. We pray this in Christ Jesus' name. Everybody say,
amen.
In the book of Acts, I want to talk about two men today, but what is it to have the boldness in Christ? There's a lot of us, we have boldness in a lot of things, and I really don't have a hill of beans, as the word say, but when you have boldness in Christ, Lord have mercy, you got you something. Let me give you the backdrop of our text. The backdrop of our text is that the lies of Nero, who was a Roman emperor, has spread it throughout the world. The Christians was under now on a heavy persecution. And as a result, Rome had opposed all teachings regarding Jesus Christ and his resurrection. Yeah. You see, as long as they was talking about Jesus while he was walking the earth, that was okay. But when Jesus got up out of the grave, then people started talking about it. So hold on, you can't talk about the resurrection of Christ.
All right.
In chapter 2, despite opposition, the Bible says, being filled with the Holy Spirit, Peter and John preach the good news that Jesus has risen. How many of y'all know that's good news?
Amen.
In fact, the Bible says the good news produced in Acts 2 a massive church growth. In chapter 3, filled with the Holy Spirit, Peter and John, they was at the gate at the temple, and there was a lame man who everyone knew that was birthed. But God gave them enough spirit filled that when they spoke a word to this man, the man jumped up and leaped, even though everyone knew he was lame,
Amen.
And I know the question may be come from, why would God give believers such power?
Yeah.
Well, then as the day, Jesus was showing his creation that he's still alive and working through his believers. Truly, y'all, we are the incarnation of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We are his hands that does his work. We the feet that carry his message, and we are Jesus' mouthpiece that proclaim the living word of God.
Yeah.
Think about this. If Jesus would have ascended to heaven, and no one carried on his work, nor no one had the boldness to proclaim his work, then who will believe in Jesus?
All right.
Jesus taught us this in Matthew 10. Matthew 10 says this, verse 27. Whatever I tell you in the dark, speak it in the light. And whatever you hear in the ear, preach it on the housetops. And do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul, but rather fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Therefore, as we examine this text, let us have two questions on our mind. The first question is, am I a witness for Jesus Christ, or am I a witness for myself? The second question I want you to ponder is, am I driven by the love of God, or am I driven by the acceptance of man? Are y'all hearing me?
Yeah.
And I tell you, you find Peter and John probably wrestling the same questions. Look at verse 1. Now, as they spoke to the people, the priests, the captain of the temple, and the Sadducees came upon them. Wait a minute. The priests represented the theological views of their society. It was the priest. He had the word. The captain of the temple represented the political forces of their society. The Sadducees represented their religious disbelief because they fought change from the law. When I researched this, I realized that it was 5,000 people in the temples on the porch of Solomon that day. Some was ready to kill to keep the law, and some was ready to kill for their belief in Christ. The Bible doesn't tell us their emotional state at this time. It doesn't tell us what Peter and John was thinking. But I have to believe that when you have all this opposition against you, hey, y'all have opposition against you? You start thinking about everything negative that can go wrong. But they did not think that way. The Bible shows us that Peter and John had the boldness to speak the truth, because they believe in the truth. And once you believe in Jesus Christ, if you really believe the truth, then opposition have no place in your mind. Are y'all hearing me? Paul told Timothy like this, God did not give us the spirit of fear. So we don't fear oppositions. Oppositions fear us. Because we have the truth in our heart. We have the boldness of Christ, and we learn to speak it. And believe what you're speaking. Opposition will back up. Are y'all with me? Tell somebody there's power in the name of Jesus. And when truth is spoken, look at verse 2 to 3. They said, the leaders became greatly disturbed and arrested them. In other words, they became in agony. And when you look up the word agony, agony is beyond anger. I mean, these people was mad. They mad because they're speaking the truth. Now, why would you get mad over a dead man if he didn't rise? They know Jesus got up, and they know all power is in the name of Jesus. And because the power is in the name of Jesus, it was losing that power on earth. So now they're getting mad. They said, we got to shut them people up because they're talking too good over there. They're talking about the one that can destroy us all. They're talking about the one that if everybody start believing in the name of Jesus, we can't have no power over them anymore. Why? Because the world thought they got rid of Jesus. And when they thought that they got rid of Jesus, then they can have self-power. But how many know you can't get rid of Jesus? You can take prayer out of school, but I'm guaranteeing somebody's going to pray before they take a test. You can tell me that I can't raise my but bring my Bible to work, but I guarantee that Jesus already wrote the laws in your heart. Are y'all hearing? You can't get rid of Jesus Christ. He's here forever and forevermore. If the teachings of God cease to exist, then man has no hope. Philippians 4:13 teaches this. I can do all things through Christ who what? Strengthens me. Not because you're that good, and not because you have any kind of way, but you can do all things through Christ Jesus. Not on your own. It's through Christ Jesus that we have victory. And because, how do we get that victory? Because he strengthens us. And a man without hope become a slave to poverty in the world system. You become a dormant when you have no hope. When you have no hope, you lay in bed all day and start thinking about what else I can do. When you have no hope, you don't put that job application in even though it has been, oh, you're not qualified. When you don't have no hope, you sit there dormant and you don't fill out college applications because you don't have the finances. Because you have hope, you don't take a test to get to the next rank. When you have no hope, you don't sit there and try to make the best out of everything, because hope is all that we have for, and a child of God can never, should never not have hope, because 1 John tells us we live for the blessed hope in Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Are y'all hearing me today?
Amen.
Hope would have you in poverty. Mm-hmm. Hope would have you sitting home hoping that you watch those soap operas pretending to be one of the characters on there.
Yeah.
Hope. Lack of hope will mess you up.
Yeah.
And that's why I tell people, have hope. If you don't have anything in the world, you gotta have hope that Jesus Christ will make a way for you.
Yeah.
You gotta have hope.
Yeah. Hope.
Hope will have you become poor and enslaved. Lack of hope will have you poor and enslaved. But thank God, God is our strength.
Come on.
I believe Peter and John knew this, and that's why when the Sanhedrin Council caught them to vote, they didn't change their word. They didn't backstep what they said. No, they said with boldness that Jesus Christ is the one who we will preach.
All right.
And I look at these brothers, I say, man, y'all bold.
Yeah.
Y'all stand in front of 5,000 people and proclaim the word of God.
Uh-huh.
Then I realized the Great Commission teaches us to make disciples.
Yeah.
And that requires us to seek the unsaved and to spend time investing in them.
Well,
you know the old saying, if you stand for something, you'll fall for what?
Yeah.
Anything.
Yeah.
As a Christian, if we don't stand for Christ, then we bow to Satan.
Yeah.
You see, there's no middle. If you don't stand up for Christ, what you're saying is, okay, Satan, I will bow down to you.
Yeah.
And if you're not trying to bring people to Christ, then you're entrusting those people to Satan.
Come on, man.
Because there's no middle.
Yeah.
You can't walk past an unsaved person and say, well, you'll be all right, somebody to come along and witness to you.
Yeah.
Why? Because God has entrusted his word in you, and you are a vessel for him.
Yeah.
And if God placed you in a situation that someone need to be shared the gospel truth, you need to open up your mouth and have the boldness to proclaim God's living word. Because somebody's proclaimed the word to you. And without that word in you, baby, you have no hope. And that's why the world is in the state it's in. We're in a dark time right now. But I understand how our fathers, how my mother and my father and my grandmother went through the depression and still alive. They didn't commit suicide because they had hope in Jesus Christ.
Right.
I understand how the slave owners whipped our ancestors, but yet they still picked their cotton and sung a hymn in the middle of a field because they had hope in Jesus Christ. You gotta have hope, ladies and gentlemen. If you don't have hope in Jesus Christ, you will be dormant and dead.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Thank God for hope.
Thank you, Lord.
Now don't be fooled. The word of God has power.
Yeah.
And when you stand in boldness, look what happens in verse 4. However, many of those who heard the word believed, and the number of men that came to was about how many?
5,000.
You talking about a revival. That's a revival.
Yeah.
The first word that says, however, however means despite of. Despite the opposition from religious leaders. Despite the political forces that was around them. Despite the denominational barriers, 5,000 people came to God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Not because society believed, but because John and Peter believed.
Yeah.
You see, society wants you to be ignorant.
Mm-hmm.
Society wants you to have no hope. Why? Because the less you have, the more powerful they are.
Yeah.
But when you try to rise to their power, they try to take the hope from around.
Right.
Are you hearing?
Yeah.
But you don't depend on that hope. You depend on the hope of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Because the hope society gives you is not hope. It's dope. That thing will mess you up.
Yeah.
You got to believe in the pure hope of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Because truth be told, I can't even think out why we still got the penny. What can you back for a penny? But if they take the penny and the nickel away, it weakens the dollar. And it weakens the dollar and make them less powerful.
Yeah.
Are you hearing what I'm saying today? Don't let people keep you down. You got to have hope in Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Hope. I got hope.
Hope.
You got hope?
Yeah.
Somebody say hope.
Hope.
Oh, I got hope.
Hope.
Hope in Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Yeah.
They believe the word of God. Peter and John. the work of God.
Yeah.
And they believed the unity in God. 5,000 people came to Christ. Mm-hmm. No job is ever too small for the Lord. Mm-hmm. No job is never too big for the Lord.
Yeah.
Because God's children, we have hope.
Yeah.
You may be wondering, who am I to change society? Mm-hmm. Chapter 2 told us this. These men change not by their education, but they change by fasting and praying. Meaning, we can start off with ourselves. Mm-hmm. You can't change nothing unless you change.
Yeah.
You gotta quit telling people to be like you and you know you ain't got it.
Okay.
Hope is what we need, but you got to change in Christ.
Yeah.
When a man became closer to God, being in his word, fasting and praying, then they went out and sought to do the will of God. Are y'all hearing?
Yeah.
I want you to note the flow of the text. When they got closer to Jesus, they were able to face life changes and began changing the world.
Yeah.
How many times have you walked up against opposition and you felt like there was no way out of this? When you felt like all hell has broke loose in your life. Mm-hmm. When the hell hounds are constantly nagging at your ankles.
Yeah.
And you're drowning from ear, from end to end. People talking about you.
Mm-hmm.
You feel left out because you don't have what other people have.
Yeah.
I know God got a testimony from one saint here that he has made a way out of no way.
Yeah.
He has blessed those who come to him in hope.
Yeah.
Verse 5 and 6 tell us this. And it came to pass on the next day that the rulers, elders, and the scribes, as well as Ananias, the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and as many as were of the family of the high priest, were gathered together in Jerusalem. Man, the whole world has came against Peter and John. But how many of y'all read Isaiah 54:17? No weapon to form against us would ever prosper. Research tells me that it was about 70 to 80 men with verse 15 defined as the council. This was like their Supreme Court, y'all.
Yeah.
Here they guys are in the middle of the Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. One swing of a gavel, they could have been executed. Mm-hmm. How many know Jesus is power?
Yes. Yes.
Jesus said in verse 1-8, you shall receive what?
Power.
Like us today, with the Holy Spirit, these men did not crumble under pressure.
No.
How many times have you been down and out and the Spirit lifted you up?
Yeah.
How many times you've been down there moking and crunking and you feel like the weight of the world is on your shoulder?
Yeah.
But when you get out on your knees and you start calling out to Abba Father, it seems like when you get up off your knees, the weight of the world is gone. It feels like the door that was closed and now open.
Yeah.
It feels like that you can now see through the muck and miry clay.
Yeah.
These brothers were sitting there in the middle of the Sanhedrin Council.
Yeah.
And because Jesus promised him that these men stood boldly before him.
Yeah.
Look at verse 7. I heard these men say, and when they set them in the midst, they asked, by what power or by what name have you done this?
Yeah.
Here they are. Can you see them? In the middle of all these people.
Yeah.
Enemies round from wall to wall.
Yeah.
Can you see them?
Yeah.
And they remembered a conversation. I wasn't there, Pastor, but I remember when Jesus told Luke them something.
Yeah.
It's recorded over in Luke 21, 12, and 15.
Yeah.
I bet you Peter whispered over to John, hey, brother, do you remember what Jesus told us?
Yeah.
You know, John said, what did he say? Jesus told them, they will lay hands on you.
Yeah.
And they will persecute you for my sake.
Yeah.
But I will give them wisdom, which all your adversaries will not be able to contradict or resist.
Yeah.
I know you're wondering, Pastor, why you think they whispered it to each other?
Yeah.
Look in verse 8, and it shows. Peter filled with the Holy Spirit. Right there would tell you that God was in the midst. Said to them, rulers and people and elders of Israel, if we this day are judged for the good deed alone, to a helpless man by what means he has made fail, let it be known.
Yeah.
That here they are standing with people that can knock them out. But Peter said, let this be known.
Yeah.
In other words, your terminology, don't get it twisted.
Yeah.
We did it in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
And because we did it in the name of Jesus, you can't mess with us.
Yeah.
Because my Father promised me, as long as I stand in boldness,
yeah,
as long as I'm a witness unto him, he will always be here with me.
Yeah.
And I can see John get cocky now.
Yeah.
Peter even might have got that switchblade back out. Peter was a bad boy, but he told him, it's not about me, it's about Jesus. And when you're talking to somebody, understand that it's not about you, it's about Jesus Christ who saved you.
Yeah.
Are y'all with me today?
Yeah.
God will give you power to do the will of his job.
Yeah.
I don't understand sometimes how I stand behind the podium, but the power of God comes in me.
Yeah.
And when I understand that I'm telling you the truth, the Holy Spirit takes over and God sends down his anointing.
Yeah.
And when God sends down his anointing to spread the truth, has to come out.
Yeah.
You may be a liar on Monday, but God will make you a saint on Sunday.
Yeah.
Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
God can change your world around. He can fix it that you tell the truth.
Yeah.
You may be lying, but God will say, I got enough of that.
Yeah.
I need to clean your mouth out.
Yeah.
He'll put the Holy Spirit in you.
Yeah.
You be telling the truth on Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday.
Yeah.
On Friday night, you'll put down the bottle and tell the truth all over again.
Yeah.
You will go in the club you used to be in, preaching the name of God.
Yeah.
Because when the power is in you, David said, Jeremiah said, like fire, shut up in my bones.
Yeah.
I got to tell it. I got to tell you that God is able, y'all. He's able to save and save your soul. He's able to build mountains. He's able to lift you up. He's able to pick you up. He's able to keep you up. Man cannot destroy you with God means. Are you hearing? That's the kind of God we serve.
Yeah.
Peter and John was in the midst of these people. And they weren't even afraid.
Yeah.
But they told the truth. And the Bible says the truth shall do what?
Set
you free. I want to bring some to you. Note the text. The government and the religious leaders never asked him, how can they help this young man?
Yeah.
But they want to know about what authority they did such a miracle.
Mm-hmm.
I'm telling you now, the government really ain't about helping. The government really wanted to know, how did you heal this man without us?
Yeah.
What they really want to know is, how did you make it without us? But you don't need, I'm sorry, Obama is the president, he's a good man, but you don't need President Obama or President Omar.
Yeah.
Who you need is Jesus Christ, who's on the throne.
Yeah.
Are you hearing what I'm telling
Amen.
You? Just because he's in the White House don't mean he's in a big house.
Yeah.
Jesus is in the big house.
Yeah.
And as long as Jesus is in the house, the tomb is empty, the grave is empty, there's hope.
Yeah.
Tell somebody, I know, don't know what you're going through, but there's hope. Because when you sat outside the tomb and you begin begging, the government will leave you right there.
Yeah.
They'll pacify you for giving you enough money just to make it until next time, then you got to beg again next month. Are you hearing?
Yeah.
But when you have hope in Jesus Christ, God will lift you up out of there. Your dollar will go further than you ever seen.
Well, yeah.
He said, if you tithe and offering, he said, I will bless and I will protect your money from the devourer who come to get you.
Yeah.
Are you hearing?
Yeah.
God is a true God.
Yeah.
He is the truth, and in the truth.
Yeah.
Ain't he the truth?
Yeah.
Y'all don't believe, ain't he the truth?
Yeah.
Give God some praise.
Yeah.
He is the truth, God. God is the truth.
Yeah.
I love this part.
Come on.
Notice the boldness in Peter and John. Knowing that they could be killed. Knowing that people would turn their backs.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing that they may lose their jobs. You know, he was the wealthiest people in the land. In boldness, they said, "It's nothing we or you done.
Yeah.
But let this thing be known
yeah.
that it was Jesus Christ who saved this man."
Yeah. Yeah.
You need to go on your jobs and say, "I understand I went to college, but let it be known.
Yeah.
I ain't get this job because you gave me the interview.
Yeah.
I got this job because God placed me here."
Yeah.
You let the contractor know, "I may not have enough money, but my Father in heaven will pay this note."
Yeah.
You got to speak it and understand that God is the one, the reason why we are there.
Yeah.
Give God one more praise. I know you ain't got to praise him. They wanted his men to be broke down. He was standing on a step begging, and nobody helped him.
Yeah.
But yet, God sent his willing vessels. And they said, "Brother, I can't give you no money.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have any silver. I don't have any gold.
Yeah.
But what I can give you is that would help me. And I can give you," what's that? "The word of God." And evidently this brother must have listened, because they said, "Fix your eyes upon me."
Uh-huh.
And he said, and what they was telling him is, don't concentrate on your issues.
Yeah.
Don't concentrate on your poorness. Don't concentrate on your limbness. Don't concentrate on anything around you. That negative spirit I told you last week to mess you up. He said, "Look at me. Focus on me. Focus on the word of God." And when that boy turned and he focused his eyes on the word of God, God lifted him up.
Yeah.
The Bible says he jumped up.
Yeah.
And he walked.
Yeah.
Now everybody know, once you get new legs, you got to go where? Therapy.
Yeah.
This man didn't go to therapy.
Yeah.
He didn't go to the doctor. He seen the true doctor.
Yeah.
Jesus fixed him.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, when Jesus fix you, he'll fix you good.
Yeah.
When he clean you, he'll clean you good.
Yeah.
When God open doors for you, he'll open doors well.
Yeah.
You don't need the government. You need Jesus Christ in your life.
Yeah.
God is hope. Tell somebody, God is hope.
God is hope.
Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus is the cornerstone of our faith.
Yeah.
Because verse 12 says, "Nor is there salvation in any other."
Yeah.
"For there is no name under the heaven given by which man must be."
Save.
It didn't say it shall be, but must be saved.
Yeah.
Everyone believes in something. Why is it so hard for people to believe in Jesus Christ?
Yeah.
Truth is, it was Jesus that came down through 42 generations.
Yeah.
It was Jesus who walks amongst men. No other deity in the scripture or in history claimed to walk amongst men.
Yeah.
Why? Because Jesus was telling you that I care for you. Jesus was showing you that I love you. He got this man from the lowest point in his life.
Mm-hmm.
And he built him up to be with him.
Yeah.
Jesus would do that. Jesus meets you at your lowest point in life.
Amen.
When you think that it's all over. Right before you hit the ground, Jesus holds out a hand and said, "I got you." Why? Because he came in his lowest form. Nobody came and got this man but Jesus. Don't fool yourself. All people who laughing and how he hard with you, get broke one time.
Yeah.
Then be home.
Yeah.
Mess up one time.
Yeah.
They talk about you like a dog.
Yeah.
Husband, you wouldn't let men come up in your house because when you slip one time, you know, you hear?
Right.
Women, quit talking about your man at work because they're really just trying to get with your man anyway.
All right, come on.
Ain't nobody faithful to you like Jesus.
Yeah.
He loves you. He said, "I will be there for you."
Yeah.
Trust this. When you speak the truth, look what happens. Verse 13. "Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John," I'm going. "And Peter and perceived that they was unclean and untrained men, they marveled, and they realized that these had been with Jesus." When you talk and you walk in faith, men will start identifying you with Christ. And to man's eyes, these was the lowest men in society. But look where they are now.
Mm.
The Bible says the counsel the wise, the rich and powerful are marveling at what's coming out their mouth. Lord have mercy. In closing, Jesus will use you. Jesus will go to the lowest ends of the earth, and he will take that person and he will rebuild you. He will reshape you, and he'll rise you up and make your enemies your footstool. Yes. Verse 13 indicates, according to this, no weapon formed would ever destroy God's children, because God is our hope. He's the hope for our future. He's the hope to all that we need. John and Peter was known as uneducated, untrained men. And God, when he got them, in fact, in the book of Acts, when Jesus ascended to heaven, he said, oh, men of Galilee. Why? Why did the writer put that in there? Because that part of Galilee was known to be a foreign town, uneducated people. God took them uneducated disciples and made them to be honored. That's what God would do. If you're looking for humility, look for Jesus. If you're trying to find him, go to the bottom of the barrel, because that's where Jesus is at. He's looking for those who want to be saved.
All right.
Everyone standing.